Yeah, so this talk is about microservices security. And so if you have any questions, please feel free to ask it any time. So I usually prefer questions in the middle, like rather than waiting till the end. Let's make it like interactive two-way discussion. Yeah, first of all, why do we need to worry about microservices security? Like, so we've been doing security for a long time. We've been securing our web applications. So why do we need to treat microservices security as a different kind of a beast? Okay, so to find answer to that, let's have a look at how security works in a typical monolithic application. So this is a monolithic web application. You can see in a typical web app, you have only a couple of entry points. It can be the HTTP endpoint or HTTPS endpoint. And all the requests coming to your web app will be intercepted by some kind of, let's say, if it's a Java application, it can be a servlet filter or a Tomcat valve. And it does centrally authenticate the user, then authorizes the user. After that, it'll create some user context or user session. And we'll dispatch the legitimate request to the downstream components. And all these components you see here, they run in the same process. Right, so the communication between these components, they happen locally, and they have direct access to the user session object. If any of these components wants to do local authorization, then they know who the user is, so they can find the user's attributes by looking at the user session. When it comes to a microservices deployment, all these local components, they become remote, right? They become independent deployments, and they talk to each other remotely. Now, like, instead of just one or two entry points, each of these endpoints become an entry point to our deployment, and all of them are part of the attack vector. So we simply broaden up our attack vector. So that's the primary challenge in a microservice deployment. Yeah, so these are a set of challenges we face, not just limited to these stuff. There can be so many other challenges. The first one we already discussed, the broader attack surface. Then again, performance. Now, when we have multiple endpoints in our deployment, we need to do distributed security screening. Instead of doing security screening at one point centrally, now at each endpoint, we need to authenticate the message, we need to authorize the message. Right? So when you design our microservices security architecture, we need to find the right balance between security and performance. So based on that, we need to pick right techniques. The other one is deployment complexities. So we do not need to like go far like to think about microservices. Even in a typical monolithic application, if we have a few nodes in a cluster, we know that the deployment is becoming complex, right? And to add on to that, if you want to manage certificates, right? So you need to provision certificates, then revoke keys, rotate keys. If you have to do that, even in a typical monolithic deployment, that's hard. Right? Now think about like not just a few nodes, hundreds of nodes. Right? How do we do that? It becomes a real nightmare unless we have proper automation in place. And then observability. In terms of observability, we worry about three things. Logging, and then metrics, and then tracing, right? In terms of security, we need to know who's doing what actions, where, when, and why, and also how. In a microservices deployment, to address a single request, right? So that request can span across multiple microservices. So we need to have proper tracing and proper correlation. So we need to have proper distributed tracing in place. Sorry. Then sharing user context. In a monolithic app, you don't need to worry that much. You create a user session, then all the components have direct local access to the user session. But when it comes to microservices deployment, how do you pass user context, the end user context, from one service to another service in a cryptographically safe manner, protecting the integrity of the message? That's another challenge. Then the polyglot architecture. So polyglot architecture is one of the driving forces behind microservices architecture. If there are multiple teams working on microservices, they may pick their own programming language, own technology stack to optimize their own requirements. In doing that, we cannot have a centralized security team whose expertise of who has expertise of all these technology stacks. Now we need to think about distributed security team, where each team, each microservices team, they have a security expert who knows about the corresponding technology stack, so they can define, help defining security best practices, guidelines, and pick tools to do security scanning, like do static code analysis, dynamic testing, those stuff. So we need to think about these aspects. Okay. In a typical microservices deployment, this is the most common deployment pattern we see. Right? You have microservices, and then microservices can talk to each other, but you selectively pick a set of microservices which you want to expose to the outside world, and they are exposed to the outside world through an API gateway. Right? Then for an API that you expose through your API gateway, there are two types of audiences. One is a system. Right? A system can directly invoke an API. It can be a web app, mobile app, just by being itself can invoke an API. The other audience is a system can invoke an API on behalf of another user, a human user. Right? Here, if we go through a flow, so we have a set of users, right? And you have a set of applications or systems, then the API gateway. So if a user wants to access a web app or a mobile app, then the mobile app trusts a local identity provider, and user will get redirected to that particular identity provider, either using OpenID Connect or SAML, any federation protocol. Now users will directly authenticate the IDP, then IDP will provide some kind of an assertion to this particular web app, and that will also include some kind of a token. Then web app can use that token to access the API, and the gateway will intercept the request, extract of the token, will talk to the token issuer, validate it. If everything goes fine, we'll dispatch a request to the downstream microservices. Right? This type of interactions we call a north-south communication. Right? So north-south communication means the end users or systems directly interact with APIs. Right? The service-to-service communication we call east-west communication. Right? Okay. This is an extended version of the previous pattern. If you look at the previous one, all the like entities in the diagram, the gateway, IDP, users, and the applications, all are in the same domain. Right? In this case, users are not in the domain of the gateway. So what happens here? Still, all your applications and nodes of the gateway will trust the local identity provider or the local SDS, local security token service. Right? And when you want to onboard an external party, let's say a partner, then you create a trust relationship between the identity provider from the partner with your local IDP. So your local IDP will trust the external IDP. Right? So the flow would be the user gets redirected to the local IDP because all the applications only trust the local IDP. Then local IDP will do some sort of a like home realm discovery to find out which identity provider this user belongs to, and will redirect there. Then users authenticate to their own home IDP, then come back with an assertion. Then local IDP will validate that assertion, create its own assertion, send it to the application. Application, since it trusts its local IDP, it will accept the user. Then the same flow as we discussed before, right? So this is north-south communication, or we call this as edge security in microservices. When we talk about security in microservices, we need to usually worry about four things. One is edge security. The other one is the service-to-service security. Third one is deployment security. The fourth one is how we do security in the development lifecycle. In this talk, we only talk about edge security and service-to-service security. Okay. Now let's worry about the east-west communication, no? Service-to-service communication. Let's see what are the patterns available to secure the communication between services. Yeah, so we've been talking about microservices for a long time now, maybe 6-7 years. But only last couple of years we've seen people are developing microservices, deploying microservices in real production setup. What we have noticed is, even though they have started deploying microservices in production deployments, they want to get things done, get things running, right? So when you want to get something done, easiest thing you can forget is non-functional requirements or security. So they try to like get things up and running and don't worry that much about security. It's not their fault. The reason is, so it is a little hard to, like some time back, we didn't have enough tooling to do that, even to automate stuff, right? This is a common pattern we see. This is where many people get started. You authenticate the request at the gateway. Once the request is authenticated at the gateway, you simply dispatch to the microservice, the corresponding downstream microservices, and request is accepted as a legitimate request purely based on network trust. You simply trust the network, and today we treat this as an anti-pattern. Right? So we go for zero trust network models. Okay? But this is what we see in common. This is a slight improvement to the previous pattern. Now, instead of trusting the network, you secure the communication between the gateway and the microservices, and also the communication between microservices with mutual TLS, right? And so that will secure like system-system communication. But how would you pass a user context? Sometimes you need to pass a user context to the downstream microservices too. Probably like if you want to do local authorization, you need to pass the user context. In this scenario, they simply pass the user context in an HTTP header, right? So that's not a, once again, fully secured approach. The reason is there is no way to protect the integrity of that particular user attributes. So when the user attributes go to one microservice, and if it wants to go to another microservice, there is no guarantee that the integrity of those attributes is protected. If the first microservice wants to change that, simply it can do it, right? Okay. Any questions up to now? Yeah.
So the integrity you meant is the tampering of the token itself.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Now let's see like how to pass a user context in a cryptographically safe manner to preserve the integrity of the user context, right? Here we use MTLS to secure the communication between service to service. So when the request comes to gateway, gateway talks to the STS to validate the token, then the gateway will issue a JWT, a JSON web token, right? So JSON web token is a JSON payload which has set of attributes, like assertions about the user. It can include attributes and other stuff. And it's signed by the secret token service, right? So you get the JWT, and you pass the user context, which is embedded into JWT, to the downstream microservices, and if one microservice talks to another microservice, you simply pass that JWT, right? So with that approach, the integrity of the user attributes or the user context is protected. No one in the middle can change, right? Then again, so this has some limitations or drawbacks. When you issue a JWT from the secret token service, a JWT has something called an audience. So if I issue you an JWT, I'm the issuer, you're the recipient, audience of the JWT is you. So that means you should not be able to use that JWT to access another service. Because each service, each recipient of the JWT should first validate whether this is a token issued to me. You do that by looking at the audience, right? That's one thing. The other thing you will also include in JWT is a scope. Scope means what you can do with this particular JWT, right? Now, in this case, we are using a shared JWT, right? So the gateway passes the JWT to the first microservice, and the first microservice could pass the same JWT to the second microservice. Now, to get this working, all the microservices should share the same audience, right? Then once again, we violate the least privilege principle. We are passing the same capability token, same JWT, to all the microservices. So all of them have the same set of capabilities. So that is why this approach still has some issues. How do we prevent this? Okay. So you get the JWT, you pass it to the first microservice. When first microservice wants to talk to the second microservice, rather than just passing the JWT it got from the STS, it will pass a JWT to the STS and will request a new JWT. So this is my JWT, give me another JWT, which is good enough to talk to service bar, right? And this gives additional flexibility at the STS level. You can also enforce some access control policies. You can see whether service foo can access service bar, right? So the new JWT will have a set of limited set of scopes as well as the audience pointing to the second microservice. So this is a much better way of doing how you pass user context between microservices. Okay. Any questions? Yeah.
So is the JWT time-based token like Kerberos so that you can have perfect forward secrecy?
That's right, yes. JWT is time-based, yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
In this approach, there will be a lot of network calls.
Yeah. Yes. So there are ways to prevent that, right? So once again, we need to find the right balance. When you get a JWT, so JWT is self-contained. You don't need to talk to an endpoint to validate it. But then again, if you want to talk to an external endpoint, yes, you need to do that. Yeah. I'll give another example, right? So even not just a JWT, even when you use MTLS for service-to-service authentication between services, you need to worry about the expiration time of the certificate, right? So once again, it depends, the expiration time you pick depends on the level of security you want. If you take the Netflix deployment, the service-to-service communication is secured with MTLS, and they use short-lived certificates. So that means expiration is around 4 minutes. So why do they do that? Because they cannot, or in a typical microservice deployment, we cannot totally rely on the certificate revocation, right? So there are multiple ways of doing revocation. One is certificate revocation lists. The other one is OCSP endpoint, right? In either way, it's unreliable, right? So see, if you make a decision on a CRL, which is cached, right, then you may make security decisions based on some stale data, right? And even OCSP, even with OCSP stapling, if the OCSP endpoint is down, what should we do? Should we allow the request or block the request? So those are the questions. So what people are doing now is they don't worry about revocation rather than go for short-lived tokens, right? So for Netflix to do that, it's not easy. You need to have the right level of infrastructure. To provision this certificate, rotate these certificates, you need to have the right level of infrastructure, okay? Yeah. Now, so there are multiple ways of doing that. This particular JWT validation, either you can build by yourself, right? So you get a JWT, your microservice can be Ballerina or Spring Boot, you do validation yourself. Or else, you can use some kind of a proxy. This is the preferred approach in a microservice deployment. Why? Because one base principle in microservice architecture is your microservice only worry about one thing. So the business microservice will only worry about the particular business functionality. It won't worry about security screening, validation, those stuff. So you can have some kind of proxy sitting in front of all these microservice instances, which knows how to do an MTLS handshake with the gateway, which will trust the certificate corresponding to the gateway, and then do this JWT validation, and also do the JWT token exchange. Right? In the Kubernetes deployment, right? So this is a pod, microservice and proxy, both in a single pod. And so that means proxy and microservice both are co-located. And the communication between microservice and proxy, they are local. Right? They don't cross the network. And this we call the data plane. Right? So you have a set of microservices, and we also call this a microperimeter. So if you're familiar with this zero trust concept, zero trust network concept, with zero trust network, at a very high level, it means you don't simply trust a network. So if you don't trust a network, then you need to keep policy enforcement points or security checkpoints as much as closer to the resource. Right? In this case, the resource is the microservice. So you have the security checkpoint proxy as much as closer to the microservice. Right? So this is the data plane. And you also need to have some kind of a control plane. Right? So you have the policy enforcement points running in the data plane. Then control plane defines the control instructions. Right? You define certificate management, how to provision certificates. So whenever a microservice spins up, you may provision certificates. Then how to do key rotation, how to do key revocation. So that's defined based on the control plane instructions. You have a question? Yeah. Yeah. You can use some kind of existing proxy. For example, if you like, Envoy is one of the very popular proxy. If you are familiar with Istio, so Istio uses Envoy in its data plane as a proxy. So all the requests coming to your microservice will be, and also responses going out of microservice will be intercepted by Envoy, and it will enforce its policies. So you don't need to worry about anything developing this stuff. You just need to configure it. OK, so I'll come to that too, right?
And,
yeah.
One more question to that is, I was under the impression we were planning to do is send the second microservice back to the API gateway, even if it has to go to the service 3.
Yeah.
We were planning to send it to the API gateway itself. Is that a better one, or is it better to talk?
Yeah, you don't need to do that, right? So the practice is, if it is north-south communication, so that means end users accessing your APIs, so that goes to the API gate, right? Then service mesh, okay, I did talk about service mesh, right? So this pattern we call a service mesh pattern, right? So service mesh is an architectural pattern, right? There are multiple implementations of service mesh, Istio, Linkerd, so those are service mesh implementations. So that helps you to bring in best practices in security, resiliency, how do you do traffic control, observability into your microservice deployment, right? Now, the service mesh happens in east-west communication between microservices, right? Then the micro gateway. So micro gateway is mostly, once again, comes through east-west communication. So you can have microservice at this, the micro gateway at this level. There can be multiple microservices deployment behind service mesh. You can group them together with a micro gateway. Right? Yeah, so then authorization policies. So once again, you can define authorization policies at the gateway. And there are multiple patterns how you can enforce these authorization policies. One is embedded PDP pattern. The other one is call home pattern. We'll discuss that too. and logging and monitoring. So each proxy can push data to the control plane. Then routing instructions, once again, you can define at the control plane and feed into the data plane. Okay, so this is how you can do authorization. So first one, you can see the left-hand side. It's the column one. So you get the JWT, which carries the user context. Then the proxy will intercept the request and call a policy decision point running in the control plane. So only if it is permitted will dispatch a request to the underneath microservice. The other approach is, so this has a performance bottleneck. You always need to talk to the control plane. Other approach is to deploy your policy decision point as a sidecar in your pod itself. So it's local to your microservice and the proxy. So proxy won't do a remote call to the control plane. It'll simply talk to the PDP and see whether the user is authorized or not. In this approach, there's an overhead. You need to worry about how do we push policies from control plane to the PDP, which is embedded to the microservice. Right? So in the Istio architecture, so this is done by a mixer plugin. So Istio, like in the current implementation, authorization, the PDP runs in the control plane. So there's an authorization plugin. From Envoy, you talk to the mixer plugin, and then you authorize the user. Okay. Okay. So this is the end-to-end flow. You have the end users. They want to access the web app. The web app trusts the local IDP. Users get redirected to the IDP. Users authenticate. Come back with an assertion. Then you get a token. So here we use OO2O. That's the de facto standard for securing APIs. Then you pass a token along with the API call. Once again, if you use web applications, you can use OO token OMTLS, right? So otherwise, OO tokens are bearer tokens. So bearer tokens are like cash, right? So if I steal $10 from you, I can use it any way I want. No one will question, right? The other type is called proof of possession tokens. So if I steal a proof of possession token, I cannot use it anywhere. It's like a credit card. So if I steal your credit card, when I use it, I need to prove that I own it by signing the transaction, right? So you can make it a proof of possession token by using MTLS. But once again, you can use this for web applications, but it's tricky to use that with a native mobile app or with a single page application, unless you have the browser support. So in the previous session also, we talked about this token binding. So token binding is an RFC by IETF, but Chrome had support for that, and they removed support. So unless your browser support, you cannot use token binding with single page applications. So now request comes to the gateway. So gateway will talk to the IDP or the STS to validate that. Then STS will issue a JWT, which is signed by itself. You pass it. Once again, that channel is also secured with MTLS. JWT carries the user context, and it hits the proxy, right? So proxy will do access control, validate the token, checks the audience. And basically, to do the access control, once again, you can do it based on the scopes in the JWT. And it trusts the JWT because it trusts the token issuer. Then we'll dispatch a request to the microservice. And when that microservice wants to talk to another microservice, once again, the outbound request goes to the proxy. It'll do a JWT exchange and get a new JWT to pass the user context. Once again, that channel is secured with MTLS. So this is an end-to-end flow. Yeah. Any questions?